you know, today we're talking about a couple of things. We're going to be talking with the adults, and we're going to be talking with everyone a little bit about a word that we're going to learn about. But first, I want to give everybody something, okay? I want you to open it here, okay? Not just yet, David. Okay, now that everybody has one, and everybody's good. Well, that's not it. You didn't get one. Really? So what's wrong? You should get one, right? I think you probably should get one. Okay, so I'm going to give you one. Is that good? You hate tomatoes? But why is that not good that you got that and everybody else has this? It's unfair. But does it make you feel like maybe you're not included in everybody that has some candy? It feels kind of weird, doesn't it? So I'm going to fix that right now. Now, I like tomatoes. So I'll take my green tomato back, and you can have that. So, what does included mean? What do you think, Davis? Included. I don't know. Yeah, but if they don't include you in the game and you're not part of it, how do you feel? Left out? Kind of sad? Uh-huh. Like, did you guys all have one of these? Oh, yes. Did you get one of these? I will give you one, okay? Now, this came about as a way to represent what we're doing in the church, okay? If you have one of these, you're part of the building blocks. You're part of what we're doing and what God is doing in the church with the adults. We're going to be doing something new. Your mom was talking about it this morning a little bit. We talked about it in Sunday school a little bit. We're building on something that we feel from the ground up is going to be great and be different. Okay? But we want everybody to be a part of it. Now, what if nobody came to your football game? You'd feel kind of bad, right? You feel like you weren't included? What if they went camping? What if your mom and dad went camping and your sister and you weren't invited? Terrible, wouldn't it? Yeah. What if your granddad was watching a NASCAR race car race and he didn't let you come in there, didn't invite you in to come and watch it? Oh, boy. That'd be bad, wouldn't it? Torby, what if Mama came home from where she was working and she didn't grab you and say, hey, you wouldn't be excited, would you? It'd be different. Right? So we're included in a lot of different ways. And how do we know all these things about you guys? How do we know about football and camping and NASCAR and all the drivers' names and that your mom flies in planes? We know all this. How? Because we love and care for you. And you guys are included. In addition to being included in your group of friends, in addition to being included in your football team, in addition to being included in your home family, turn around and look at all these people. You're included in something that's much bigger than you, right? So if you ever have trouble, you ever run into things, there's a bunch of people that want to help you. There's a bunch of people that are part of your extended family, okay? I don't know if Adam's ready. You ready, Adam? I want to test you. I want to see who God includes in his family. We're going to see somebody up here. God include that in his family, that person? Sure. Dogs are part of our family, right? Our extended family. What else we got? How about this person? Huh? Is that person included? I think that person's included. How about this person here? Yeah, he's included, and also he's also working. He's doing something that he likes to do that makes him feel included. What about this person? See in there? She's out there pulling potatoes. That was a fun time. Everybody knows that Glenda pulls potatoes pretty good. Okay? What about this next person? is not a person, but you like them. Yeah, that's included in what you do, right? So I'm going to count them in. I'm going to put them in, okay? How about this next person? Ooh, it's a girl. Is she included? Well, sure she is. If you like them. Well, that's an interesting point. Dalton said everybody's included if you like them. What about people you don't like? Are they included? Yeah, God's going to include them. We were reading in Sunday school this morning about these bad people. And they just didn't do the right thing. But like sometimes Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is a great example. This is. So you can do things wrong. You can do things wrong in your family, but you're still included. Okay? You know who that is? That's Miss Cheryl. How about that? And you know, I don't remember when she was that size, but you know what this family does? Do you know that your daddy, when he was little, I taught him Sunday school. Just like you're being taught Sunday school now. And he learned, and we moved on like that. But that's Miss Cheryl. Next one, see if this person's good.
Peppa Pig.
A pig. But that was for Evie, if Evie was good.
Okay.
I'll save it for her. Now, here's another one on there.
A tiger?
That's a strange looking tiger. I must say that was something I didn't consider. Well, I suppose he was at one time up there with God, wasn't he? But now he's kind of against it, isn't he? I don't think I'd want to. I don't have a pig up there rather than the devil. So I think if you think of all those people, there's only one that's not included, right? So when you think about the whole situation, about being included. So when you think about being included, we are all included. Except for that one guy, right? Except for that guy. God threw him down. He didn't want to be included. So to be included in something bigger is the point. To be included in a family, to be included in something that makes you feel like you're a part of something. Okay? Do you get that feeling when you come to church? How do you get the idea that you're a part of God's family? In God's family. But what makes you know you're included in God's family? Yes. But he also, what are we doing here? He lets you in his house, doesn't he? This is God's house, right? What else do we do? Oh, it's difficult, huh? Do you read or listen to Bible stories? Yeah. So are we learning there? Are we learning to be included and to be part of something? Okay. What else do we do that knows we're included in God's kingdom? Do you say your prayers? Sure. Do you talk to God? Do you think he's listening? I think so. He's always listening. Good point. Good point. What else do you do? He's always with you. Do you listen to your parents? He never leaves you. That's a good point. That's a high five. All right. So we never leave you. You could give a high five to you. All right. So what else? The other big thing is that you do participate.
Mommy wants a high five.
Mommy wants a high five. I'll get her later, okay? Okay? All right. So what else? So we participate, right? We participate in this family of faith. We participate all together. There are things that we have to do that we've never done before. Things we may have never considered doing before. Right? Oh, golly. And it's always what we do with that. It challenges us to make us stronger, to make us better. Okay? And we make us better to be better servants, not only in God's church, but in the community. And overall, in the end, we're nice to everyone. Even those that aren't nice to us, because everyone is included, right? Everyone's included in God's family. So let's, before we go, let's say a little prayer together, okay? Gracious God, we thank you for being in your house today. We look forward to opportunities to be included and to bring other people into this family of yours as well. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. All right. Well, thanks, guys.
Please join me for the prayer for illumination. Heavenly Father, quiet in us any voices but yours. Help us to hear your word new today. This week, help us to see those around us that may need to feel included in the family of God. In your name we pray. Amen. Today's scripture lesson, Old Testament reading today, is Job 38, 1 through 7, and then 34 through 41. It's in your Pew Bible, Old Testament, page 484, if you would like to follow along. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is this that darkness counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy. Can you lift up your voice to the clouds so that a flood of waters may cover you? Can you send forth lightnings so that they may go and say to you, here we are? Who has put wisdom in the inward parts or given understanding to the mind? Who has the wisdom to number the clouds or who can tilt the water skins of the heavens? When the dust runs into a mass and the clods cling together. Can you hunt the prey for the lion or satisfy the appetite of the young lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in their covert? Who provides for the raven its prey when its young ones cry to God and wander about for lack of food? This is the word of God for the people of God.
Our New Testament reading comes to us today from the book of Mark. It is chapter 10, verses 35 through 45. It may be found in your Pew Bibles on page 47. Hear now the words of our God. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it that you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" And they replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to him, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I was baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You knew that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as the rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so amongst you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave to all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." This is the word of God for the people of God. Do you ever read those billboards going down the highway that are about God? I do. Some of them are pretty good. Some of them are really rather amusing. These are some of my favorites. "If you must curse, use your own name, God." I also like this one. "That love your neighbor thing, I meant it, God." Then, of course, there are ones that make me go, because I question the theology behind it. For example, the billboard that reads, "Lonely, confused, angry, depressed, Jesus is the answer." Or even this one, "In despair, Jesus is your hope." And finally, this one, "Who stole Jesus?" I didn't think he was stolen. But it seems that the world has boiled down Jesus to be the answer for all of our problems, an easy fix, the way out of troubles if we just pray hard enough. Boiled down theology, an easily manipulated God. So we have to ask ourselves, where did the way of the cross go? Solve my problems, God. Help me, and only me. And this is a really good example. Oh, well, our example isn't going to come up, but I will tell you what it is. There's a little example, and it's called God Bless America and Nowhere Else. And maybe we will have it after all. Any luck?
The mouse on the computer is cutting in and out.
Oh, technical difficulties. You know we all have them from time to time. Just when we use computers so much, that's the when it doesn't work, you know? But anyway, so it's a little clip, and this gentleman is running for office, and he says at the end of his speech, God bless America and nowhere else. And then Chris Rock replies, America is the richest, most powerful nation in the world. How about God bless Haiti? How about God bless, you know, Afghanistan? How about God bless South America, where all those immigrants are running? How about God bless some of those folks? How about God bless some of the suffering in our own communities? And here's the clip, and Chris Rock does it much better than I do. There you go. I told you, you did it better than I did. So, we have to ask ourselves, where does this self-serving theology come from? Well, a lot of it comes from the modern-day evangelical movement, unfortunately. Now, evangelicalism is defined as the attempt to lure people towards the gospel, the effort to win people to Christ by putting forth all the benefits of following Jesus. Will Williman, who teaches at Duke Divinity School, said that his church once hired a consultant to help grow their congregation. And the advice that the consultant gave them was, first find where people itch, then find a way for the church to scratch that itch. The church is here to meet people's felt needs. The church is here to meet people's felt needs. Now, I think this advice is a prime example of confusing or even replacing the true benefits of following Christ with the benefits that our culture teaches us as being the way to true happiness. Now, back 20 years ago, there was a book released called The Prayer of Jabez. Do any of you remember it? Okay. And the prayer goes like this. Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. Now, I remember it because a couple of my friends were all abuzz about this particular prayer. That somehow, magically, this prayer would make them wealthy and healthy. Now, this notion was not discouraged by the author. Greg Gilbert, in his review of the book, points out these two things. Look at the introduction to the book, he says. The very first sentence of the preface says this: "Dear reader, I want to teach you to pray a daring prayer that God always answers." That is just a ridiculous statement and very unbiblical. And he had that thought, and it remained unqualified through the whole book. But Christians need to recover the idea that faith is not defined as believing that God will give us what we want if we just believe hard enough. A lot of this distortion, unfortunately, comes from the proponents and the pushers of the prosperity gospel. The prosperity gospel movement, as researched in Kate Bauer's book called Blessed, traces the history of the prosperity gospel in America. She says that this movement rose out of the New Thought movement of the late 19th and early 20th century. Now, this movement originated as an offshoot of Pentecostalism in post-World War II America. While it started in local congregations and in tent revivals, the movement gained a larger following through the use of radio and TV and became firmly entrenched in the 1980s with the rise of televangelism. The prosperity gospel, also known as prosperity theology, is a religious belief among some Protestant Christians that financial blessings and physical well-being are always the will for God for them, and that faith, positive speech, and donations to religious causes will increase one's material wealth. The prosperity gospel teaches us that we live for God's material blessings. Now let us look at our story from Job. Job teaches us that we live for God's eternal glory. At the heart of the prosperity gospel is our value. At the heart of Job and all of Scripture is God's values. Satan is a proponent of the prosperity gospel, as he tells God that Job's faithfulness is predicated on God's blessing. In our Old Testament reading, Job has questioned why all that suffering has happened to him, that his righteous behavior should have protected him from suffering. And God answers Job in a whirlwind, and he responds not by evaluating the merits of Job's cause, but by rather questioning his knowledge of the mysteries and purposes of God. Both speeches are characterized by a barrage of rhetorical questions designed to fully disclose Job's inadequate understanding of God's governance of the world. Let us return a moment to that prayer of Jabez. The point is not that Jabez's prayer has some kind of magical power in its words. The point is that Jabez's God has the awesome power to change a person's destination or destiny from curse to blessing. In a commentary I read, it said that for the original audience of the Book of Chronicles, who have been through the experience of divine curse in the shape of expulsion from their homeland, and who have now returned there, this was good news indeed. Though they may have been born into a people who were under God's judgment, The curse could be transformed into a blessing by God's hand, which is stretched out in response to his people's prayer. The point of 2 Chronicles 7:14 is that if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive them their sin and heal their land. Jabez provides yet another proof text of the power of prayer, which is a key theme in Chronicles. Now, my fellow Christians, I invite you all to reject these biblical distortions, and I offer you an invitation to the Sufferers Club. Sounds like fun, doesn't it? Who's willing to join? I see a show of hands. So here is James and John. They're not willing to join the Sufferers Club. They think they're on their way to power and glory. They want a piece of the action, a piece of the pie, so to speak. After all, they've been tromping through the land following Jesus. And despite what Jesus has told them over and over again, they still don't get it. But before we judge them too harshly, let us remember that we know the end of the story. They didn't have any idea. You know, it's a funny thing about us humans. We all see the world and make judgments about the world through our own lenses. Each one of us has a different lens, and each one of us, that's why we have, you know, 30 different opinions probably in this room. We get our viewpoints from our teachers, from our parents, through our ministers, from our culture, and from our own life experiences. So too with James and John. Now, I would imagine that their whole lives, they were told and they prayed for a Messiah who would come and restore the glory of Israel, right? So what would that glory look like? Well, perhaps it would look a lot like the Romans. Beautiful palaces, abundance of food, great wine, and an army that would conquer all new lands. So if Jesus was going to be a ruler of this new and improved Israel, well, then they were looking for cabinet positions. The mere idea that to be a servant leader was a complete turn from what they were told that leaders were. Leaders weren't servants. Leaders got served. It was countercultural and not an idea that would send the Romans running away from their land. So now we may easily make a viable connection between the suffering servant of 2 Isaiah and Jesus. Suffering is a part of discipleship. God's people are not spared the pains of sojourning in a foreign land, in a world that is not our own. It is when we leave the comfort of our own world lens and look at the world through the eyes of others that are different from us, then we know. And once we know, we can't unknow what we know, right? So, I'll tell you a little story. When I lived in Jacksonville, Florida, I decided to put my kids, in a magnet school. Well, this magnet school was on the wrong side of the track, so to speak. It was in a predominantly African-American neighborhood that was a ghetto, for lack of a better term. You know, I'm lived all my life in suburbia, a white woman, middle class. What did I know of a ghetto? I remember driving down there, parking my car, and saying to my kids, run, let's run quick like bunnies into the school. I admit it, I was a little scared. And then I started to notice some things. It's Florida, after all, but this school only had window air conditioners. The roads in this neighborhood were pockmarked with they were not maintained. Let's just put it like that. You had to be really careful when you drove down there that you didn't get a flat tire. They were building an addition to the middle school up the street. Well, they put in this drainage ditch. And it was, you know, grass and quite steep. And so I called the city because I was like, what is this? And I said, how deep is that ditch? And he said, well, it's about 36 inches. You know, I come from a family of short people, so I measured my kid. He was 36 inches. So if he fell into that drainage pond, he would drown. So I said to the man, I said, well, how long will that drainage ditch take to drain? And he said, it'll take maybe 24 to 72 hours. I said, well, how many kids do you think will drown in that drainage ditch in 24 to 72 hours? And he said, they should be watching their children. That's subtle racism. They should be watching their children. I said, have you ever been down here when the kids get out of school? No. Mm-mm. I said, well, you know, they're running here and yonder like all kids do. Some of them walking home. And, you know, the parents in this community are mostly working. One or two minimum wage jobs to put food on their table. I said, so, you know, my son's 36 inches tall, and this makes me very upset. So I'm going to put it to you like this. If any child drowns in that drainage ditch, or what I now call the community pool that you have established for this neighborhood, I will personally make sure that they sue you. So you had better put a fence up around that thing, and it better be put up by tomorrow. And it was. But you see, the moral of this story is, do you think that would have ever happened in a white middle-class community? Not on your life. And what I also learned about these folks is that they had no trust in government. They had no trust that they were going to be treated fairly. Why? Because they never had been treated fairly before. I also learned a few other things. Believe me, I learned more about sending my kids to this magnet school than they did. Well, my son had a friend in his kindergarten class. His name was Freddie. Freddie was African American. Kyle, obviously, was Caucasian. And they'd get stamps on their hands. Kyle was like, Freddie's stamp doesn't show up like mine does. He had no idea about color until somebody was going to teach him that. And then me and Freddie's mom, Kyle and Freddie, all decided to go to Chunk E. Cheese. All right, so we're standing there. And she had the coupons for Chunk E. Cheese in her hand, and we were going up to pay, and the cashier never spoke to her. Looked right at me, though. Spoke right to me. Subtle racism, my friends. And that's what I learned. And guess what? I can't unlearn it. And now, since my eyes have been open to that, I see it all the time. But we have to be open to other people's experiences. We have to open our own eyes to enter into somebody else's suffering. We we may easily make a viable connection between the suffering servant of 2 Isaiah and Jesus, because suffering is a part of discipleship. God's people are not spared that pain. It is when we leave the comfort of our own world lens and look at the world through the eyes of others. Remember that saying that you will never know what life is like until you walk a mile in their shoes. I would have liked to have played this song by Everlast for you because it's a great example of that, but it's got some bad words in it, and I didn't want to shock any of you. Not that you haven't heard them. So I will have cleaned it up, and I will read it to you. I can't sing because that would be suffering and for you. We've all seen a man at the liquor store begging for your change. The hair on his face is dirty, dreadlocked, and full of mange. He asks a man for what could he spare with shame in his eyes. Get a job, you slob, is all he replies. God forbid you ever had to walk a mile in his shoes, because then you might really know what it's like to sing the blues. Mary got pregnant from a kid named Tom that said he was in love. He said, "Don't worry a thing, baby doll. I'm the man you've been dreaming of." But 3 months later, he won't date her or return her calls. And then she heads for the clinic and gets some static walking through the door. They call her a killer, they call her a sinner, and they call her a whore. God forbid you ever had to walk a mile in her shoes, because that's when you really might know what it's like to have to choose. I knew this kid named Max who used to get fat stacks out on the corner with drugs. He liked to hang out late, he liked to keep pace with the thugs. Until late one night, there was a big gunfight, and Max lost his head. He pulled out his chrome 45, talked some trash, and wound up dead. Now his wife and his kids are caught in the midst of all this pain. You know that it comes the way, at least. That's what they say when you play the game. God forbid you ever had to wake up to hear the news, because then you might really know what it's like to have to lose. We cannot truly be members of the Sufferers Club until we can look at that suffering through other people's eyes. We can never know what racism is like until we are open to seeing the systemic racism in our own society. We have to be open to learn about suffering that happens every day around us. Suffering, you know, is easy to ignore. We are spared most of that suffering in our lives. But leadership in Jesus' way means to follow and serve. And it may even mean to suffer for the sake of the gospel. After all, Jesus suffered and died so that we all might live. You know, my clients, who are all in the midst of addiction and struggling to get better, but what is unique about that, if you really get to know them and you really listen to their stories, you will find that underneath their addiction is suffering, is trauma, horrible, horrible trauma. I had a client whose mother put him in a bathtub of scalding water. He lost all of his toes. I've had clients who have been raped, not by strangers, by their own daddies. I've had clients that have suffered unbelievable physical beatings. And usually all of this is coupled with intense poverty and lack of resources. And what they always said to me is the shame they felt. And the shame comes from people like us who judge them without knowing their true stories, without knowing or even bothering to listen for the suffering that undergirds them. So that is what a member of the Sufferers Club is, a decision to be a radical disciple, to open our hearts and minds to the broken world in which we live. When we open our hearts and minds and are willing to share in the suffering of others, or when we suffer ourselves, we open ourselves to be truly dependent on Jesus. When we are willing to drink from his cup, it joins us together. It includes us all in the family of Christ. Now, I know this is a message that is hard to hear. It's kind of human nature to want the easy way of the gospel, isn't it? The one that gets us what we want. However, Jesus was not sent to fulfill that kind of theology. Jesus was sent so that God can get from us what God wants, not what we want. Jesus was always sent for us to seek the way of the cross, no matter how big a burden it might be thrust upon us. Now, Reverend Willimon recalls these stories, and I'd like to share them with you. He said when he was in campus ministry, a fellow campus minister asked him to participate in a baptism of a graduate student. And this graduate student was from China. He had been attracted to the Christian faith while a student at Duke. And the Reverend Willimon says, I met him once or twice before. And so, you know, I was so excited to participate in this baptism. And I thought it was a great idea to bring my camera and take a few pictures. And so I said, after I posed everybody and got them all smiling at the same time, I said to the gentleman, you can send these pictures back to your family in China. You can share your baptism day with your friends at home. And I noticed, you know, he said he noticed that the group looked a little shy and awkward, but they all stood together for the pictures. And after the baptism, the campus minister came up to him and said, oh, that was embarrassing, you with your camera. Embarrassing, he said, why? Well, he said, because now that he's baptized, his life has been ruined. His parents say they will disinherit him. The government will probably take away his scholarship. He can't show those pictures to anyone back at home. His life, as he knew it, is over. He's been baptized into Jesus. You will be baptized with my baptism. And he went on to tell this other story. A young man, he was a Baptist, and he became an active Christian in high school. And he was going through a turbulent period in his life. In an emotional youth worship, he gave his life to Christ. And he said of his conversion, I have now found what I've always been looking for. So Reverend Willimon said he went to visit him. And he found that he was running a ministry for inner city kids in East St. Louis. He lives in a dangerous, tough part of town, sharing the lot of the kids who have come to his ministry. He's been a victim of crime on a number of occasions. And Reverend Willimon said, I marveled at his faith and his faithfulness. And the young man replied, well, it's sort of what you get sometimes when you get Jesus, he said with a smile. I thought I found Christ when in reality Christ found me. I thought he wanted to give me something. Well, he has given me many good gifts, but mostly what Jesus gave me was a job to do for him, rather than to do what I wanted to do for myself. You will drink out of the same cup that I drink. So once again, I invite you to join this sufferers club. It's an inclusive club. You can all be included in it. It always leaves an empty chair at the table as Christ beckons you to join. In that club, you probably won't find material riches, no power, probably not even some glory. But what you will find is joy through service, happiness in humility, and a true abundance of life. Amen. And now let us join together and sing hymn number 87, Love of God, in the hymns of